I'm Chris Weir, and this is the Chris Weir Experience, and we are on episode number 4 of The Daily Weirdo. And today we're going to be talking about negativity creating negativity. And I've got back with me my good friend Scott Wunderlich. Scott.
Hello.
Hello, welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you for having me back.
So today we're going to talk about a relatively, I think very important topic, and I think one that entrepreneurs face on a consistent basis. And I think it's one that we really, really need to address, because there's going to be a point in everyone's career where they run into the proverbial wall, right?
Exactly.
But I want to lay out a little bit of groundwork here out of the beginning. When we're talking about negativity and we're talking about all of the bad things that can happen, right? Mm-hmm. The ruts that you can get into. Mm-hmm. There is a very, very big difference from being in a rut and being depressed.
Yes,
so,
exactly.
So I want to make sure that we are very, very clear here out of the gate. Today, we are not talking about depression. We're not qualified to have that conversation. That conversation needs to be had. If you are suffering from depression, or you think you might be suffering from depression, I'm going to put links in the description below. Check out some of those links. Look into it. As I was looking into it, I was learning a lot about depression that I didn't even know. Symptoms that I wasn't even aware could potentially be symptoms. So if you think that you might be on the verge or in the middle of depression, or you think that's a possibility for you or somebody that you know, check out a couple of the links that I have in the description. Go read into it a little bit and look and see. And if you think that might be you, this is not a video for you. No. We're not talking about that. That is a very serious conversation that needs to be had with someone who, quite frankly, knows what they're talking about in regards to depression.
Exactly.
We don't, right?
And this is just getting yourself out of that rut.
Exactly.
Getting yourself out of, you know, that negativity and where that negativity can take you, as well as just hopefully what we have done to get ourselves out of some of the negativity.
Exactly.
And to talk about some of our stories of how, you know, negativity has actually affected, how it affected me, how it affected my family, how it affected my clients, you know, and everyday stuff. So this is not depression. This is just when things happen, how do you handle it?
Right. And I would be, you know, remiss if I did not say out of, you know, just up front and out of the gate, there will never in business, there will never be a problem that you cannot overcome. Ending your life is never a solution to a business issue. We can give you solutions. We can give you help. Mm-hmm. We can do all kinds of things. There's plenty of people out there that can help you if you're in depression. Please do that. Now, that's the serious side of this conversation. We're going to leave it there. Again, I highly encourage you to take a look at those links. For the rest of the conversation today, that's not what we're talking about.
There you go.
we're talking about the rut. Mm-hmm. We're talking about when you get trapped inside of that hamster wheel of negativity where it just seems like every single day something else has now come up to either knock you down a notch or to piss you off or to put you in a bad mood or to make you feel like you're taking steps backwards. So that's what we're talking about today when we say negativity. So have you ever run into, Scott, a situation where...
Seriously, it was like probably about 2 or 3 months ago when I had a lot of work. Everything was going really, really well. But I was still going negative because even though a lot of the positive things were happening, and this is something a lot of entrepreneurs will also think, you always focus on the negatives. No matter how many clients help, you know, say, hey, oh, Scott, good job. Thanks for doing this. Thank you for your help.
Right.
You know, yada, yada, yada. You always have that one or two clients that are just negative about their project. Oh, this is going to go so terrible. And it's hard to get past those guys, and it's hard sometimes to get past their criticism of you. One thing I've learned, you're going to have criticism, plain and simple. Some is going to be good, some is going to be bad. And I don't want to sound like a self-help type of guy, but you have to focus on the good. So when you get those some of those negative things thrown at you, You have to focus on some of those good things. Remember those good things. Now, granted, if in one day your dog dies, you know, you get the flat tire, you know, you get the extra, oh, crud, I screwed up on my taxes. I owe another $1,000 to the IRS. Hey, entrepreneurs, it will happen, by the way. you know, those type of things, yeah, it's hard to find the positive stuff in that. You know, and I'm not trying to be a, you know, like I said to Chris before this, I'm not trying to be the Lego movie, you know, saying right. everything is awesome. You know, it you can't do that, but you have to look past all those things and look at some of the goods. If you got a bad criticism, don't take it as a bad criticism.
Right.
Maybe take it as a learning.
So what can I make out of that? Yeah, so before we go into solutions. I might be going way off. No, that's cool. No, that's perfect. So before we even go into solutions, so I want to set the stage for possibles, right?
Okay.
So there's a great example of how it may seem like a lot of things are going very well and business is picking up. Negativity can seep in at any point in your career or your business, right?
And negativity also can come from your family life.
Sure.
From other things that are going on. You are an entrepreneur. You know, your family life and business life are mixed.
It is.
You have,
whether you like it or not.
Whether you like it or not. There's going to be times at 10 o'clock in the evening, mm-hmm. you're going to be working on stuff.
That's right. You know, should be in a lot of cases. But,
and,
but yeah,
you know, like Chris always said, there is going to be a time where you're eating shit. And you might be a little negative about that.
Yeah.
But you got to look past all that.
Right.
You got to look at what this is teaching you.
Yep. So for me personally, this was about 2 years ago for me. I hit a spurt that lasted shy of a year. I mean, it mm-hmm. went for, I guess, maybe 10 months, 11 months, something to that effect. But this was as I was wrapping up my last agency, and you know, and I've told the story a few times before, and if you followed my content at all, you've already heard the story. But for those of you who haven't followed my content, as I was wrapping up my last agency, it was just, it seemed like one negative thing after another every single day. It all kind of started rolling downhill with the one client who skipped out on two invoices. And I mean, it was a massive amount of money for my small agency. So that negatively impacted my relationships with other clients, with obviously mm-hmm. those vendors, with other vendors. I mean, and it spread out, right? It just did its spider web effect across all my business. And then of course, it obviously started impacting me personally
and
my
family
life. And so it was just every day it seemed like something else was going wrong. And it was the most frustrating thing I had ever dealt with in my life. And I'm going to tell you, I used to smoke cigarettes for many, many years when I was in Iraq. And this was 2009. Yes, 2009 is when I was in Iraq. I was smoking a pack and a half, two packs a day. I'm not even kidding you. I mean, I was a chimney stack. It was bad. And
there was a little bit of stress there, though, too.
Well, yeah, but yeah, even before then, right. I would love to sit back and say, oh, it was all the stress of Iraq, but it wasn't really. It was just me smoking. But I quit smoking, and it was hard and it was tough, but I got through that, and I got through that much quicker than what I got through all the negativity that was happening in my business. So it was very frustrating for me as I sat there. I'm like, my God, I have overcome things worse than this. I mean, I've had a lot of negative things happen to me in my life, and I was able to bounce back and get over that. And for whatever reason, I was stuck in that rut there for those 10 months. So today I want to talk about strategies that you and I have used personally that we've actually put into practice that we can talk about and maybe help some of you who might be, maybe you feel like you're stuck in a rut. Maybe you're getting really busy and you've got a lot of stuff coming at you and it just feels like you're getting overwhelmed, or maybe it's the exact opposite. Like for me, it's going the other way. Everything was going bad at that time and I had, you know, some issues with clients and I had issues with employees and turnover was ridiculous. And oh my God, it was just endless. All the situations. So, there's a lot of different forms that negativity can take in business and in life.
Oh, yeah.
So let's kind of start talking through maybe some of the solutions, right? Okay. So let's start with you. Why not, right?
Why not?
That's
why you brought me in here, right?
That's exactly why you're here, right? but seriously, let's talk with you. So yours was a few months ago, and you were just getting overwhelmed, getting busy. A lot of things were piling onto your plate. Talk me through mentally. Like you said, right, so you said very surface level, you've got to think positive. Okay, that's the Tony Robbins version of it. So now let's get down and dirty. What does that mean?
How do you think positive? Exactly. How do you, you know, take that? And, you know, like I said, once again, I'm not the Lego movie type of guy. Everything is awesome. I didn't mean to say something like that. But, you know, there comes a time when, you know, you've been criticized even just a little. And as an entrepreneur, you take everything, I think, a little more personally.
Okay.
I think we can, you know, say that. I think you worry about things a little more. Hey, how does this one bad criticism affect my
reputation?
Know, business and all?
How does
and
it
start,
affect
you start thinking
multiple
negatively
levels.
About, hey, you know, how can, you know, how is this going to hurt me in a way? And I think that becomes like a negative type of thing where you're dwelling on, you know, that negativity.
Right, right.
You know, I've also been in the situation before, same thing 2 months ago, where I'm just negative about the process that I'm going through.
Mm.
You know, I'm negative about...
I remember that.
You know, geez, making the decision. Should I hire someone? Should I not? Should
right.
I go a contractor? Should I not? Should I do an intern? Should I not? You know, type of thing. You know, for me, a lot of what I did was try to turn it around into teaching experiences for myself.
Okay, so let's break that down. Let's break that down step by step. So you recognized, not immediately, right?
That's a very good point.
Mm-hmm. So you didn't recognize immediately that you were going into a rut of negativity, right? That kind of sneaks up on you a little bit.
It does. You are 100% right, because you know what? You have that bad criticism.
Right.
Okay? And then you might get a second bad criticism. And then you might be thinking to yourself, you know, just in doing something, or what the hell was I thinking in this design? Or what the hell was, you know, I thinking? And you start almost not believing in yourself,
mm-hmm.
which is a form of negativity. You're not trusting yourself in your
sure.
abilities.
Sure.
You know, which can, you know, just tumble you down a hill and snowball you down a hill. And when other things in your life, a simple flat tire, your kid gets, you know, called in the principal's office. Oh, crap. Now I'm not a good father as well. Now I'm, you know.
And that all starts becoming bigger than what it actually is.
It becomes bigger than what it actually is.
Because it's piled on top of something else now.
And some of it's stuff you can't control.
Right.
You can't control. You do not know when your tire is going to go flat. You don't know when your engine's going to blow a rod. Yes, that happened to me. It was wonderful on the I-10. I was that guy who kept all of you from getting home on time. But, you know, it's a time that you have to really stop and think and see, A, how can I learn from this?
Right.
B, could I have controlled that? And C, is this just part of the crap of life?
So how long did it take you to get to that point where you
It probably took me 2 months.
Okay.
Because it did just build up and build up and build up, you know.
And what did that look like? When you finally stopped and said, you know what? Or was it gradually, I gotta
you know,
reverse this? Or what?
One thing, not letting things fester. And I think that's one thing. Look at the things you can control and, you know, get them done. Look at the things that you can talk to. When I had that client, you know, give me that bad rapport, you know, other than instead of just kind of shooting back at him saying, no, you're stupid, you don't know architecture,
sure.
you know, and all this, talk to him. Mm-hmm. Talk it through.
Did you do that?
Because I did. You know, I talked to the doctor and I said, well, why didn't you feel this? Well, it wasn't what I expected. And then I'm, you know, talking him through it, and I find out that he's a big fan of the HDTV stuff, and he's figuring, oh, this just happens in a week. Oh, this happens. It's that expectation thing.
Right.
Oh, I can't control that. But now that I know, you know, that client took it you know, how can I say it, the process a certain way.
Right, right.
I took it as a learning experience to say, you know what, maybe I need to educate my clients a little more on the whole process. Maybe I need to walk them through a little
more. Well, you know, you're cheating a little bit here, just so you know, because you're skipping ahead to what I want. What I was going to say, you skipped ahead to one of the solutions that I was going to provide, which is managing expectations. Because I think that comes to the core of almost everything. You hit on such a key point in all of this. Is managing the expectations, not only our own, but of those that are around us that could affect our
And I think the step before that is realizing, A, you know, you are in a rut. A, you are feeling negative. I mean, at the same time, I sent out probably two emails that I had to send out an email right away saying, I am sorry for this email. I didn't mean how it sounded.
Mm-hmm.
Second point. Always reread your emails before you send them out.
Note to self.
Note to self. Just always second guess, second read them. Don't have someone else read them because I will have someone else read them and no, you're not understanding what I'm doing. Read them yourself and see how you would react to what you're saying.
Right. Let it sit for a little bit, too. Don't write it and read it.
Exactly.
Write it. Let it sit for a second. You know, I like to leave them overnight, come back the next day if I can, if I have that kind of time.
Yeah.
And, but anyway.
But that negativity thing is letting someone else control my thoughts about me.
Right.
And letting someone else control my thoughts on my entrepreneur, on my business. You know, a solution, you know, to that is you got to recognize when you're getting yourself in a rut.
So let's get down in the weeds. Let's get down way granular here. And I know I'm kind of harping on this a little bit, but I want to get down really, really deep in this. I really, really want to add value here. No.
There we go.
Tell me about that day. Literally, that day, what you personally did in your situation, not macro. Let's get down very micro. And that morning you woke up and said, you know what? By God, I'm changing this.
You know what, for me, I always do lists, but I when I do my lists, I do a general list. Hey, I have to get A, B, and C done. I want this done by the end of the week, blah, 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 blah,
blah. Right.
I set down a list. I set down a goal. I almost set down a little meeting agenda of what I needed to do to get out of this negativity, to get out of this thing of this person is saying I'm not good. I need to address that. And, you know, I put my little bullet points together, you know, to, you know, almost get a little bit of a plan to win it. And then I had to decide, how am I going to address this? Am I going to go right to the client and talk to him about that negative comment? Am I going to go to the contractor and say, you know, dude, do you see what I did wrong, you know, here or why this guy's harping? And I will tell you, there was one client when I went to the contractor and he says, no, dude, this guy is just harping on us left, right, center.
Sure.
This is just this guy.
Right.
And so you can't.
And that'll always happen. That'll always happen.
But I'm just saying you need to, you know, you need to guard yourself on some of this stuff, you know, especially, you know, but that day it was just that, how can I say it? It was just realizing what I had to do. It was really looking at the negativity. Right. What was that root of the negativity? You know? Yeah. And, you know, looking at it, yeah, it was, you know, the bad, you know, criticism that I got that I took personally.
Okay.
You know? And then it's just defining that and seeing, hey, how can I fix this? Going into the solution thing. With this guy, I decided, you know what? Maybe I need to find out more about what's at the root of his criticism, you know, because I'm here going away in my mind, oh, I did this wrong. What did he really think it was wrong?
Because the alternative would be, and maybe this is what took 2 months, right? And I don't know, I'm just throwing out there, but is the alternative or what maybe you did out of the gate here was kind of just let that sit out in the universe with no action behind it. So you got the negative criticism that we're all going to get eventually, right? You took that, you got that negative, you internalized it, Mm-hmm. Which is not by itself a bad thing, well, right? You can you improve to, from right. that, right? So that's okay as because long as you're goes, using it for improvement. Because
that does go back to the thing is you need to learn from exactly. every criticism.
Exactly.
Is so, it valid? Is it not valid?
Some of them are just, mm-hmm. you know, they're in a rut or they're in a bad day, well, I mean, or whatever, yeah, right?
They might just be that person.
So, but
the EGR person.
Exactly, yes. right? So then it's so you the alternative, right? The way not to go then would be to take that criticism and just let it piss you off and then just try to keep moving on.
Exactly.
And try to ignore it and drive on.
Because you can't be fake about it either.
Right.
You know, you can't put on this patina face of, oh, okay, Mr. Client. Oh, okay, Mr. Client. You're right. You're right. You're right. There are times when, yes, the client is right. But there are also times when the client is, you know what, you're not educated on this, which is maybe my job to educate you on why I did what you did, why I did what I did.
Right.
Because he might not see the reason why I did what I did. Right. He might not see, you know, the overall, you know, thinking of this, right. saying, you know, hey, you know, this is a code issue. If that is out of my control, you can be mad at me all you want.
Right, right, right.
But
right.
it's, you know, it's really just getting down, you know, communication, however you want to say it, especially for this one time, you know, in this, you know, situation of just finding that cause from him.
Right.
And then I decide, you know, which way to go with it. Oh, you know, you think X, Y, and Z, you think I did this wrong.
Right, right.
You know what? I need to educate you about the process.
But step one was really just identifying and getting, and
you know what?
Clearly defining what the actual situation was.
When I was getting up probably for the, you know, over that 2 months, probably that last week, it was the idea, dang it, do I not want to do this anymore? Do I not want to, you know, do I just want to go get a job with the city? You know, type of thing. Because, you know, there's always that pull back into, you know, the corporate side. Always that pull and being an employee and all that. Not that being an employee is bad.
No, not at all.
But if you're an entrepreneur and you really want to, you know, be that, you want to be the dog, you know, in that park, you know, you don't want to be an employee.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly.
And especially once you've tasted it, you don't want to go back.
Right, right, but, sure. And you know, and that's funny that you and I didn't even know that you were going there. I didn't even know that you had those thoughts about possibly working for the city. And that's so funny that you say that because, you know, if you know, looking at my situation and what I went through, right, and as I was going through all the negativity that just kept piling up on me, a couple things that you hit on are exactly some things that I experienced. And I think probably
every entrepreneur, I think, will.
Sure.
Because you always think, oh, the grass is going to be greener over here.
Sure.
Well, you know what? When you go back in the real world, you're still going to have clients.
Right.
And some of them are going to be great, wonderful. I love you, all my clients.
Right. But no, when I was going through all my negativity, I mean, that was me. So first and foremost is I was taking whatever negativity happened and trying to put on the fake face, right? So I go back. There's really two ways you can go with mm-hmm. something that happens negative in your life, right? Two different ways you can go. One is you can just kind of self-fulfill. You can just be in a bad mood, get pissed off about it, and get madder and madder every single day, mm-hmm. and your negative attitude is going to attract negativity.
Though, prior for that 2 months, I was doing what you were doing, just put on the happy face, okay, client,
right.
you know, and all that.
Which is the other way that you can go, is you can try to fake it until you mm-hmm. get out of the funk, right? And at the end of the day, I think the theme that kind of, and that's exactly what I did, right? Mm-hmm. I was putting on the happy face. Nobody knew that I was having the problems that I had. I didn't want anybody to know that I had the problems that I had. That was probably a lot of ego. And I think one of the biggest reasons after coming out of that year, I was so adamant with you when I sat down and said, we need a big dog group where the two of us just sit down and we bring on some other entrepreneurs and business owners out there that are going through this stuff and be accountable to each other so that we kick each other out of the funk when we get there. Because I didn't have that. I didn't have that accountability. I didn't have that support from somebody else. You know, you mentioned it in the first episode, being on an island, right? I was out on that island and I was trying to fake it every single day. Well, here's the problem with faking, right? Is when you fake it at the end, when you finally, you know, get down the road a little bit, it was all fake. You didn't fix anything.
Right. Exactly. It's the still problem there. Is still there.
It didn't go away.
client may think everything's nice and rosy right. and, hey, everything's going great now, but it's still festering inside of you, right. and you still have that negativity that you're holding on to mm-hmm. because of that comment, because there isn't any, I don't want to say closure to that.
No, you're right.
But maybe it is closure.
It is closure. You're right.
You need to get that closure for yourself.
Right.
But you need to find out how to do it mm-hmm. in a way that doesn't put the client down. You right. don't sound defensive. You don't sound like you did something wrong. Or if you did do something wrong,
right.
admit it.
Yeah. Hey, well, see, and that's part of it, right?
Right.
Because if you're faking it, you're not identifying.
Right.
Not only are you not identifying what you could do better, you're not identifying mm-hmm. in your situation, right? So you right. took it and you said, okay, let me sit down and think about this. Let me get the perspective of the client for a moment. Let's right, figure exactly. out where the client was coming from, and now I can move forward. So for me, as I was sitting there and all the negativity was happening, I was avoiding what you did very quickly. I took forever to do. I was avoiding even having that conversation with myself, and I tried to push through and drive on and fake it until I got out of the funk. Well,
I have to say, too.
It didn't work.
when I was doing it, too, I didn't have any... or I shouldn't say a lot of, you know, personal issues that were going around that just felt like, you know, like God is against right, me or right, something, you know, right. of that nature, or the universe is against me. I didn't have any of those, or I shouldn't say that. I didn't have any really large ones going on. Yes, life happens. You're going to have to get through
it. But you know what? I kind of wonder, though, Scott, do you think that those start coming around after you allow it to keep festering and that negativity just keeps snowballing?
Them more. I think you notice them more. I think exactly. they become, how can I say it?
Exactly.
The scale of them.
Yeah.
Yes, it might be a simple thing, you know, oh, crud, my battery, my camera died.
Right.
Ah, crap, my battery, my camera died.
Right.
It's all in how you start thinking.
God is against me, exactly. my camera.
I am Job.
Jesus.
yeah, know, exactly. You know, type of thing.
Playing the Job complex, that's you right. You
know, but, yeah, it's just
Job's
one of those
character
things.
In the Bible, just in case you
didn't Bible is
that.
Good.
Look it up.
Exactly, look it up. But you know, it's just one of those things where you're at and where your perspective is, and I can go a whole different thing about perspective and all of that stuff.
Right.
You know, which we'll write that down. That'll mm-hmm. be for another topic. But what you're focusing on is what you're focusing on. Just like you said, negativity.
But it's not another
negativity.
Topic. It is this topic,
it is
and
this
I think
topic.
It is so important.
And I think you have to realize, once again, I go back to, you know, part of the solution is, you know, some of this stuff happening that you might think is negativity and, hey, this isn't going right, that's life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, life is going to throw stuff at you that you maybe not today can overcome, but you will overcome.
Right.
You type of thing. Like I said, to you, I am a cancer survivor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That wasn't a fun time. There was a lot of negativity there. There was a lot of doubt as to, you know, whatever. There was a lot of questioning. God, why are you doing this to me? There was a lot of that. You know what? But going back to the whole island thing, I had people too that I could bounce those things off.
Right.
This is how I'm feeling. You need to get that out.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's to, you know, a big dog, another entrepreneur, you know, just a friend.
Right.
You cannot be an island on
right.
this. And I think that's how negativity can really fester, mm-hmm. is if you don't get it out.
Yeah. No, you absolutely.
Know, it needs to be released,
mm-hmm.
you know, into the air. You just need to talk, even just simply talking about it,
right.
almost like peels a layer off,
mm-hmm.
like almost opens up the, you know, the, how can I say, the jar of solutions. Because, you know, this thing is stopping up that jar. This problem is stopping up that jar.
Yeah.
And you're not releasing
well, you know,
it to let it out.
And one of the things that I've always prided myself on, and one of the things that I think that I've always been able to do very, very well throughout my career in whatever role, whether it was working for someone or as mm-hmm. an entrepreneur, is I have always had the ability to get to 30,000 feet. And I always say that.
That's
I've
a big
always
thing.
Been
no,
able
it's,
to
it's
I've
a big
been,
thing.
Been able to get to 30,000 feet and been able to see the problem from every single angle. I've even talked to people, and we used to do this exercise when we would, for instance, run into creative blocks or whatever. We would literally rearrange our desk in our office. We would be on the whiteboard, and I would have everybody move to the left side of the room just so that we're looking at it from a different
it's
angle, a different perspective. Right?
Yep.
Well, what was happening to me is I was violating this one thing that I've been very, very good at, And I got down into the forest, and I could not see anything because of all the trees. Exactly. I couldn't get that 30,000-foot perspective. I couldn't see all around the problem and all the different angles, and subsequently could not see the solutions either, right?
Well, and at that point, too, that's when if you talk to someone about that, mm-hmm. they might have a different perspective. Yeah, if you get the perspective of your client, I all the time do what we call post-occupancy evaluations. Hey, doctor, what went well with this project? What do you feel, is whatever? Now, granted, it is usually that last month.
So you do a PO.
I do a PO.
I like that.
Yeah, we do post-occupancy evaluations.
And I think we're really getting into it now. Guys, this is where you really need to start listening, because now I think we're really getting granular. I think we're really getting down into the weeds now, because, like, for instance, talking to someone, I think number one, first and foremost, at the incredible top of the list is get you an accountability partner, get you a big dog group, get you mm-hmm. somebody that you can talk to. I also understand, however, we're talking to a lot of individuals who may be freelancers, who may be in very, very small markets, who may be in situations that's a lot more difficult to find someone to be able to sit down and talk to. You may be new in a market. There's all these different scenarios that might cause you not to be able to talk. So I think number one is, if you can, find a Scott to sit down and talk to, like I did, to be able to start airing some of your thoughts and allow them to come at you with a different perspective as a third party, removed from the situation where they can be at 30,000 feet. Go ahead.
Well, I was just telling you, just thinking about it too, you might be really surprised about who would fit this well. You might think, oh man, they have no idea what my mm-hmm. business is. I didn't think Chris had any idea about what my business is, but as we kept talking, we found out how similar how similar our businesses are. Right. Yes, do I use different programs? Do all of that stuff? That's tertiary. That's
right.
That's on this third. Deep down, in the entrepreneur level, it's almost all the same.
Yeah.
You could be talking, let's say you sold widgets. You could probably go talk to a hairdresser mm-hmm. that owns her own shop or something. Because even though the problems might be different, they're still the same problems.
Right.
It's still the negativity. It's still a client. It's still a sales. It's still timing. It's still budget. It's still all of this stuff. Yep. You just need to get someone to get you past that negativity.
And don't go find someone that's in a rut. Right? Find someone who's having success, who's actually doing well at this time. Right. And what's going to happen is when they get in a rut, they've helped you out of yours, you're going to be able to help them out of theirs, right? But if you go find somebody who's in a rut as well, then it's just negativity on top of negativity. And then
it's going to turn into a bitch session.
Exactly. That's it.
Right. Oh, you this client. Well, you wouldn't believe what this client is doing to me.
Exactly.
Instead of, but the step also that talking to someone, you got to do a self-evaluation. I do a post-occupancy. Mm-hmm. You have to do a self-evaluation. Sure. You have to see, and you have mm-hmm. to realize, this negativity is starting to affect me. Mm-hmm. This negativity is starting to affect my production. This negativity is starting to affect how I talk to other clients.
Oh, yeah.
It's starting to affect how I talk to my wife. It's mm-hmm. starting to affect how I talk to my kids. I hope that you have that 30,000 view where you can step back and say, that's not me.
Right.
Something is affecting me. I have this negativity. I need to rip that, rip this thing off.
Right.
I would really suggest, if you do have a wife, do not talk to her about this negativity.
Yeah.
I think you can talk to her, and people might disagree with me, and please comment or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that personal relationship, she's going to want to help you, and you're just going to want to complain. I know this is kind of like the reversing of roles type of thing here. But you know what? Your wife needs to be there for all that other stuff. Mm-hmm. You really need to find someone in the business world who really you can just, lay it out on the line with.
Which is actually where I was about to go. So, exceptions to that rule, which is, there's always exceptions to every rule, right?
Oh, true.
Your wife is a business owner, right?
So,
if your wife is an entrepreneur, then obviously there's some She has familiarity with what you're going through. Same thing with husbands or significant others. That is an exactly right? Point. Regardless.
I will say in my situation, right. You know, there are some things, yeah, that I just need to... I need to throw at you.
Yeah.
Because I need to get your view right. On it. Not, how can I say it? Because she's looking at a perspective of how does this affect my family?
Right.
You know, she's saying, oh, well, you need to get a lawyer and you need to sue them for the money. No. That's not where we're going.
But just even on a macro level, and we've said it 1,000 times and we'll say it 1,000 more, being an entrepreneur, being in business, being a professional at any level, it's not easy. Become an entrepreneur exactly. For the ease of owning your own business. That doesn't exist.
Yeah, you see all the stuff on YouTube where, oh, hey, I made $50,000 in 1 week.
Yeah, malarkey.
You might do that 1 week, but you're not going to do it the next 5.
Exactly, right.
I mean, that's possibly
you got to be the squirrel, right, at that point. But seriously, I mean, being an entrepreneur is hard. It is not easy. There's a lot of crap that gets thrown at you at all times. And I think that's good advice. If possible, keep your home life separate from your business life. I think that's right. Very, very important. You don't want to drag all now, the stress and the right. Complexities of entrepreneurship or your professional career. Again, this is for non-entrepreneurs as well. This could be for somebody just in their career at any level.
Exactly.
You don't want to drag that stuff into your personal life that has already got its own
right.
Challenges and
now,
stresses.
Now, once again, you don't want to be fake either. Mm-hmm. If you're having business problems, you need to let, you know, your partner know. You know, plain and simple. You need to be a team about it. But sometimes not always the solution, the day-to-day, the small negativities that right. Can grow into largers, you know, that needs to have a different outlet, I think.
Yeah, no, I agree. Think. So I think, first and foremost, as I said, I think the number one thing, if you can
find... By the way, scotch helps.
Yes, yeah, scotch
just let you know.
Don't listen to that
just
at
kidding.
All.
I'm just kidding. We don't want to create alcoholics. I am sorry. We are not creating alcoholics here.
This is once a week, I might add, true. Right? But regardless, so I think number one, if you can find accountability partner, mm-hmm. If you can find someone to talk to, that's great. If you can't, though, right? Let's go to step
this is a good
two,
point.
Right?
So very
if
good.
You,
yes.
If you can't find someone, then I think, you know, kind of what you did, I think, is a very, very good step. Ultimately, what I ended up doing, which is sitting down and start taking inventory. And amen. Again, yes. It's looking at it from a different perspective. We'll say that probably 100 more times tonight, but that's the thing is if you look at it from a different angle, get up and walk to the other side of the room, rearrange your office, literally take your desk and put it on the other side of the room, whatever it is that you can do to get different perspective.
Go to a Starbucks, go to a Dutch absolutely. Brothers, go to a library, mm-hmm. Think about the problem somewhere else.
Right. Right.
You know,
you have to remove yourself from the environment that's creating that right. Negativity. And then you can start looking at it and you can start addressing it. Now, does it fix overnight? No, it does not.
No.
Because I will tell you that for me, my whole rut, we'll call it just for lack of better term, my rut lasted probably about 10 months. I got on the other side of the rut where positive things started happening again. The Weirdo group started forming. We started looking at 2 Second Media at that time and started putting that together. And all these things started piecing themselves back together. And the rut reversed, right? And we started right. Going the other direction. But it did not happen in one single night. And that's kind of what I was talking to you.
It's not.
So it was where I woke up one morning. And there is all that. There's almost always that one moment that you can go back to. Now, I couldn't have told you that it was that moment. It's only in hindsight that I can tell you it was that moment. But it was in that moment I recognized and realized what I'm doing is not working. I was faking the funk. So I was trying to put on the facade of everything is fine and keep moving and pretending like nothing's wrong. And it was a point where I finally said, this is not working. This faking it is not going to sustain me at all. And it was really one of the first times in my career that I'd really run into that kind of wall right. Where I'd really hit the rut. You know, I mean, I had hit ruts before, but not like this. Not as sustained as this one was. So it was really sitting down and saying, okay, what I'm doing is not working, I've got to change what I'm doing, right? What's the definition of insanity?
Right.
Keep doing the same thing over and over, expecting a different result, right? I couldn't keep doing the same thing. Now, the solution didn't come overnight. The solution slowly came. So I started recognizing, okay, stop faking it and start being authentic. Start being real. Start talking about the problems. Right around the first conversation that you and I had about big dogs, where I sat down and said, dude, we've got to start talking. I need somebody to bounce some things off of, right? I need
to be able to get it out of your brain, because sometimes it rattles around in there.
Sure it does.
And you're not getting in any new input. Even if what I said was wrong, mm-hmm. you could still react to it and say, no, that's not the direction I wanted to go.
Right.
But even then, you just cut off this whole, you know, how can I say it, segment of, no, I don't want to go that direction.
Right.
Now you've almost defined, by not having to go that direction, you've almost defined the direction you want to go, you know, type of thing. That's the whole idea of just getting it out there.
Right.
You know, because, yeah, I mean, along with me, I need to do a self-reflection. It was a day, a week, maybe 2 weeks, you know, before I really realized, yes, I need to do this, but really got into it of,
right,
you know, all this stuff. It wasn't like I sat down one morning, you know, with my coffee.
Sure.
I'm going to self-evaluate myself. Hell no.
Yeah.
Because then you start seeing all the other little things. And you start seeing, wow, is how I, you know, wrote this email to a totally separate client who is going fine, that was kind of a little snarky, you know, when it didn't need to be.
Right, right.
And so slowly you're starting to realize... off. You're realizing, well, wait a minute. Yeah, this is something I need to do. Or you go to your next client and say, you know what? I didn't want this same thing to happen. I'm going to try this. Oh, wow, that worked great.
Right.
Hey, maybe I need to go back to, you know. I mean, it's, you know, it's kind of this whole back and forth type of thing. No, it's not just, oh, I solved the math problem. Right. I know X equals 7 and life is good. You know, it's just jumping back and forth, seeing what works, you know. And moving forward.
And, you know, one of the key tenets of, well, you mentioned two key tenets of being a weirdo, right? Number one is having patience. You've got to have patience to let the process happen, right? Now, that does not mean, however, you just sit back and let it happen, because it's not going to happen on its own. It's move yourself forward. Do something.
Right.
Move. We talked about that last week. And you know, there's a reason that this is the second topic that we touched on is... we wanted to talk first about movement and being able to create movement and motion and getting things moving forward. Because when you come to this point where you hit the wall and you hit a rut and you're in these troubles and these trials and you're trying to figure out how to get out of this, that's one of the things that is going to get you out of this is you have to create motion in a different direction.
Right.
Right?
Because, yeah, I mean, once again, I mean, what does water do when it hits an object? It hits it. Yeah. It's going to find its way around.
Right.
That's what you need to do with any of these ruts.
Right.
But you can't just hit the wall and stop. Mm-hmm. Well, what am I going to do now?
Right.
You know, you have to keep moving with it. If you know, like we said, you know, a while ago, if you hit the wall doing something, try something else. Move your desk around. Go to a different place.
Yeah.
Maybe work on a separate project. And, you know, your brain is going to open up to something else. You just got to keep doing.
To reverse a rut, you have to reverse your action. You
can't
keep doing the same things.
What's the rut
mean? That's what I was doing.
Yeah, I mean, you're in a rut. You keep hitting that wall.
Yeah.
You keep hitting that wall. That's not going to help you.
No, not at all.
Do anything.
So as I was, you know... working through mine, right? And the first thing was, you know, kind of that moment where I identified, okay, what I'm doing is not working. I've got to go in a different direction mm-hmm. here. Negativity is piling on top of negativity. I'm becoming that employee that I talked about in the very beginning where every single day the universe was out to kick my ass, it seemed like. And it was just so overwhelmingly frustrating to me. And the reason that it was getting so frustrating is I kept trying to do what I had done my entire career to be successful and just pushing through all of this stuff. And that is not the solution. And it caught up with me. And it caught up with me in a very big way to where, you know, I got kicked in the butt pretty good there for a bit. But what it did do was it did teach me that, again, these kind of things that we're going over is reversing my action, is taking a different direction, get a different perspective, take an inventory, sit down and Actually put pen to paper. Get off the damn computer. Put your ink pen on a freaking sheet of paper.
Write it still
exists. And write for a second. And actually be able to look at it and touch it and pick it up and take it to the other side of the room and
right.
hang it on the wall. Right? Post-it notes.
Oh, my there God. There you go. I mean,
my wall was covered yeah. with post-it notes as I was trying to explore avenues and explore different things to do. And so you had mentioned earlier, right. and I wanted to go here, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but I wanted to go because I started having some of the same thoughts. You had mentioned, you know, leaving and going to work for the city or whatever. I actually took that action, mm-hmm. right? And I said, okay, this is pissing me off to no end. Maybe entrepreneurship is not for me. And so I decided to go back into the workforce. I had a business that was recruiting me anyway. And I said, you know what? The hell with it. I'm going to give it a shot. I'm going to go and right. try going back in-house, getting out of the agency business, go back in-house and run a marketing department in-house. And did that for a little over a year and hated every single second of it. There wasn't a second that I was happy during that entire time. I mean, that's not true. I mean, obviously, I
got to pull this back a little. But no. You did something. You took it in sure. a different direction.
Sure.
And
sometimes a break is not a bad thing.
I will
now agree. I'm looking in hindsight. I hated every second of it, but the Weirdo Group would not exist today if I had not done it.
You self-evaluated,
yep.
and you came back to this because you know that this is where you want to be, and you wouldn't be happy anywhere else. And you also know, hey, you know what? I'm seeing how this guy's doing business. That's not how I would do it. And that's the big yeah. thing. I don't ever want anyone to think it's a failure to go back to work for someone. Because you might learn, right. A, you might get with a great company, and they might, you know, promote you and, you know, do all this because of your ideas. Hey, that's all fine and good. Or you just might learn where you're supposed to be.
Right.
And that's, I think, the biggest thing is continually to self-evaluate.
Right.
If it's one of the things that I could do for this negativity, see where that negativity is coming from. Self-evaluate. Mm-hmm. Is it me? Is it someone else? If someone else is controlling it, you need to talk to that person. Find out what that is. They might have unrealistic expectations,
mm-hmm.
and then you can't personalize that. You need to move past that. This is the one client, you know, that's whatever. You know, and just go back and reevaluate. This entrepreneur, any business is in a constant state of change.
Mm-hmm. In it has sense. To be.
Yes.
It has to be.
You are continually growing. I mean, with technology, with whatever. You are continually having to change a little bit. Now I'm not saying it's not going to be a, you know, light switch on off most of the time. It is going to be an evolution, you know,
right.
of your business, of your theory, of your whatever. But you still also, I mean, we'll talk about this later, but still have a concept and a goal of where you're going to.
Sure. No, absolutely.
But when you hit that negative, when you hit that rut, I don't want to be in this rut.
I've always talked about in business, you know, when I was coming up in sales, the cliche was, right, is always formulate your roadmap. And that kind of became this cliche thing is business plan became roadmap. And so we were all creating this roadmap for our business and what we were going to do. And I guess it was probably in very early on when I opened my first agency, I started changing it. So when we did our business plan, we would do a retreat every year and we would go and do, me and my business partner, we would do a retreat every year and we'd go do business planning. And I started changing the idea of roadmap to compass. And the reason that I did that is on a roadmap.
I like it already.
Right? I mean, as a roadmap, you really kind of lay out the road that you have to take to get there. But the fact of the matter is, that's not how business
operates. You don't have a crystal ball.
There is no paved road. Yes. In business, it is very much off-road. You are going through the fields and over the hills and up the mountainside and down the other side.
All right.
I mean,
yeah, you're right.
So you need a compass to be able to keep you aiming in the general right direction
right.
of where your goals for success lie. But there is no paved road that gets you there, right?
And that's the whole idea for your concept of your company. You know, your, how can I say it, overarching idea, your paradigm, whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. is out there.
Right.
You know, you might go this way to get to it, but you can't plan how to get there because you don't know what's going to happen in your life.
Right.
You know, you've got
to be able to react and adapt.
Oh, would you have ever thought that you were going to go back to, you know, the corporate world?
No, No.
Was that on your roadmap?
It was. You know, in fact, I probably too many times throughout my career said never. And whenever you say never, it's always going to happen, right? So,
well, that goes back to the negativity begets negativity, too. Well, sure. When you say never, you're almost setting yourself up for whatever.
Oh, yeah.
I was driving by down 7th Street, and I drove by a sign said, Jim Hankins Architect. I was like, oh, man, what a poser architect. Jim Hankins, great guy, by the way. Unfortunately, he's passed away, so I can say this, hopefully. You know.
You can talk bad.
I can talk bad about the dead, because he's not going to watch me.
Oh, my gosh.
But it's funny, because I said, I am never going to work for a guy like that, that has his name out there as an architect, because architecture is so much bigger than just a one person and a name and all that. I ended up working for him.
Right. Never say never.
Never say never.
Right. But that's
keep
the thing.
Keep your options open.
Yeah.
Keep your compass.
Because I did go back, right? But what ended up happening, though, and I didn't even realize was I had an internal compass for where I wanted to be in my life. And I think that is inherent in all of us. I think it maybe not everybody knows identified or looked at it. But I think I had that. And so me stepping away from the agency side of the business for a bit and the entrepreneur side of the business. Now, in all fairness, the job that I took was very much an intrapreneur. I was given, I know it's new slang, whatever. Just get up with the times, man.
I'm good with it.
It's okay. No, intrapreneur being the concept of you come in and you're starting up a division of the business, or you're doing something the business has not done before. So you're using your entrepreneurial tendencies to be able to start something that's within the business. I was hired on a position that never existed. Yeah, you know, it was a position that never existed. So I started up this entire concept with this company and their sales and marketing department, whatever, yada, yada, yada. But it was still working for someone. So even taking that step back, right? Even taking, or I won't even say step back, step to the side, because I continued moving forward. But
you're taking a side road.
Exactly. I still came back, right? I still knew my compass would bring me back to where I needed to be. I just needed perspective, and that helped me get perspective. So all the negative that happened during that year, I can now reflect on and say, wow, you know what? I'm really glad that happened because now I can really take a lot of positive from that.
Well, and that's the whole thing about doing the self-evaluation. Mm-hmm. Looking back at what you did, what did I do right? What did I do wrong? And that's the thing that can keep you moving in that right direction.
Absolutely.
And once again, you notice I said keep you moving.
Yeah.
That's the big thing.
And that's it. Moving. I mean, I can't even harp on that enough. I mean, that is such a good point because I think what ends up happening so many times is you get, and this happened to this employee that I was talking about. Now, this employee, I'll give you a little bit of context to this employee I was speaking about, was a sales position. It was a commissioned sales position. We offered a small salary, but it was an overall commissioned position, right? So when negativity seeped in and it started bleeding off, production started going down, sales started going down, revenue started going down, which compounded even more problems. And then it just snowballed, and every problem became 10 more problems, right? And what ended up happening with her is she got out of the agency business altogether, went and got an hourly job somewhere, and was absolutely miserable. She was absolutely miserable because what ended up happening was she did not keep moving forward. She didn't try to get perspective. She would not stop and take inventory. She just stopped and said, well, screw it. I'm not doing it anymore.
Right.
And she did take a step back. Now, since then, I'm very happy to say she has gotten back into the agency business and having great success. But it took many, many years. I mean, 10 plus years for her to finally do that. So let's save you some time. Don't take 10 years. Don't take 11 months. Don't even take 2 months, right? When you start feeling yourself getting in a rut, number one, if you can find somebody to talk to, if you can get yourself a confidant, a big dog, a accountability partner, whatever you want to call it, another entrepreneur, Sit down and talk and be authentic. Don't fake the funk. Right?
Biggest thing.
Don't sit down and say, oh, I got all these clients and this kind of stuff, but I just got a couple. Bullshit. You are in a rut. You're in a tough spot, and I need some help getting out of it. Right. Right? And I think that was a big turning point for me with you. And I even talked, and this is a conversation I did have with my wife, right, is the idea of getting authentic. And when I sat down and you and I started having our first conversations and I started opening up and sharing with you things that I had never shared with anybody about my business, some negative things that I was experiencing, issues that I was having in detail with some specific clients and things that I had done that I was ashamed, like how I had talked to clients. I wish I had never talked to a client like that. Not that I did anything illegal or unethical. I was just doing things really bad business. I wasn't doing things smart because I was just getting everything
better.
Oh yeah. Because I was just letting everything affect me negatively. So, but I sat down and was truly authentic. I truly opened up. I shared everything with you. You did not give me a solution. And here's the kicker, right? Scott never gave me the solution, right? You just gave me the ear. You gave me the platform to air it out. You gave me perspective.
I love you, man.
That I was able to, but seriously, right. I was able to say, you know, you said that, but I don't necessarily agree with that. But you know what I never thought about?
Well,
and it just started triggering thoughts in my mind that made me start.
I will
coming
say
around.
It's the same with me. With you know, my idea: do I hire an employee? Do I hire a contractor? Do I hire whatever? You know, and you know, you called me out on, well, what's your schedule? What's your timeline? How are you managing your time? Are you managing yourself type of thing? And that was just like a, sure. You know, yeah, I actually have to manage me. Mm-hmm. My time is precious. My time is what I bill. My time is how I make money. Mm-hmm. And yes, I realized it, but I heard it.
Right.
You know, and then I can say, well, yeah, I'm not doing that self-evaluation. I'm not doing that. I need to do that.
And again, even if the person that you're talking to doesn't give you the solution, they at least give you a different perspective, right? It allows you to air
and it
all
gets
of
out
your
of here.
Out. Exactly.
And it gets out of here.
Exactly.
And then you can almost go like, oh, that's crap, that's crap. I need that nugget.
Right. Right.
That's where it is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Or at the very least, you're able to air it all out. They give you a different perspective, again, regardless of whether it's the direction that you want to go or not. But by getting it out, hearing a different perspective, if you are, and here's the kicker, right? And this is the piece of it that entrepreneurs do not want to hear, current entrepreneurs, some entrepreneurs today don't want to hear, is at the end of that, right, and you still can't come up with a solution, and you still can't get out of the rut, you need to start deciding whether or not entrepreneurship is your route.
You need to
decide whether or not you're in the right company, in the right job, in the right industry. In the right field, right?
Exactly. I mean that's what you did.
Yeah.
You know, you decided, hey, you know what? I need to go this other route. I need to get out. The only way I'm going to get out of this rut is to basically hop over two lanes of the freeway.
Absolutely.
You know, and go this way. For me, I have to look at that. Do I want to go back work for the city? Mm-hmm. Do I want to be just a plans reviewer? Not that that's a lowly position or whatever. We need it and all of that type of stuff. But do I want to do that? Is that where I'm at?
Right.
You need to evaluate that stuff. It's the constant day-to-day evaluation to make sure you are still using your compass getting to where you want to go.
Yeah. Guys, we went in 100 different directions today, but I hope that you see the common theme. Mm-hmm. I hope you see the thread that we're talking about here is when you hit these ruts, number one, stop and take an inventory of what you actually have going on, mm-hmm. right? Because, again, when you're in the forest and you can't see the forest because of all the trees, you're not going to be able to get the perspective that you need to be able to get over whatever hump that you're in front of. So you have got to be able to stop and get yourself back 30,000 feet and look at the problem. If you can't do that on your own, find somebody to sit down and talk with. Whatever it is that you have to do, and we've given you a few different ways to do that today, and I hope that you're really taking these and internalizing these and then twisting them and making your own or trying our ways, whatever. But at the end of the day, it's get that different perspective, Okay? So stop, evaluate yourself, take your inventory, get a different perspective, but keep moving forward. Do not stop. Don't just give up and go in a different direction. And if that's on your mind, right? If even when I was considering and you were considering potentially going back to the city, I was considering going in-house, which I ultimately ended up doing, I never lost sight that I was going to come back here. You never lost sight that you are an entrepreneur. Even if you did go to the city, it'd be to get out of the rut. And that's always in the back of a true entrepreneur's mind. If you're a true entrepreneur, and unfortunately, entrepreneurship is so easy and so popular right now because our economy has been doing so well, it's so easy to open your own business. There are a lot of people out there right now who are entrepreneurs, who are in business, who should not be. So these ruts may be signs sometimes. And that's why we say stop, do your inventory, do your evaluation, get your different perspective, get somebody that you can bounce ideas off and that you can talk to and kind of and really just realign yourself, use your compass, get back on track, react, adapt, and just do things differently. Don't keep doing the same thing.
Exactly.
The negativity keeps piling on top of negativity because you don't change what it is you're doing. The reason that you are feeling that it's that client, and this is where I got, it was because of that client. I blame it on the client,
right,
or I blame it on my employees, or I blame it on this, and I blame it on that. But in reality, I didn't need to be looking at all of those other problems. I needed to be looking in the mirror.
I think that's the biggest thing.
Yeah.
I think that's the biggest thing. Yes, are they factors? Yes, 100%. But
they're factors that are always there.
But they're factors that are always there.
They're always there.
But you have to look at your own factors. That's you have to look at how you're reacting to this stuff.
That's right.
And how you could better react, you know, to this. What are the things that I have to change? Mm-hmm. I don't want to say change. Adapt,
yeah,
you know, to see that. And also, there might be just those clients, you know, like we said before, that's just a jerk of a client.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to happen. They are out there, you know, type of thing.
Yeah.
Does that mean I change my course? Maybe not. Still look at the good from your other clients. Mm-hmm. Still look at all these things, but constantly self-evaluating, mm-hmm. constantly be evaluating yourself in this whole process too.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying, you know, first thing, hey, jump and go into the private sector or whatever. But hey, see what it's like.
Right.
You know, that's...
Everybody's path is different. Everybody's going to get out of their rut differently. So I don't want you to think... And the reason that we've talked about so many different ways to do this is because there is just so many ways.
Exactly.
And we haven't even covered them all. But there are those foundational, fundamental things. Is number one, getting your 30,000 foot view. You've got to get your perspective correct. And when you do that, you can start seeing how you need to reverse your action. The only way to reverse a rut is to reverse your action. And
motion.
You can't
once again,
keep
motion.
Doing the same thing over and over. The stuff will just keep piling. It'll keep bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's not that the situations are getting bigger. It's not that you're having more things happen to you. That's not it at all. All those things were going to happen to you anyway. It's the fact that right here is now blowing all of those out of proportion. And you're just going to let negativity create more negativity. You've got to put that break in there. You've got to break that negativity. And that's how you're going to move
once
forward.
Again, the accountability partner, the big dog partner, that's a great thing just to throw ideas against. And even if they give you a solution that you don't like, you've already cut off half the solutions. And, you know, you have more of a direction that you know, I don't want to do that. If you say, I don't want to do that, you know where you want to go.
Yeah.
And go. Biggest thing, go.
Yeah, absolutely. Guys, thanks so much for watching the Daily Weirdo here and the Chris Weir Experience. We really appreciate it. Again, I'm never going to charge for this content. Only thing that I ask you is do exactly what somebody did for me and what somebody did for Scott very early in our career is they shared information with us. This information that we went over today, again, we went in so many different directions. We talked about so many different things. This is for somebody that's out there. This could help somebody get over a hump and realize the success and reach the goals that they're trying to reach. share this content, please. That's it. That's all that I ask for. Share. Engage with us. Give me your thoughts.
Exactly.
Tell me what it is that you do that helped you get out of your rut. We've all hit them. If you haven't hit your rut before, listen. Listen to us. Listen to the comments and the discussions that happen.
The so rut, she is a-coming.
Say again?
The rut, she is a-coming.
Yes, she is. You know, she will come.
She will
and come. And you can. You absolutely can get over that.
Mm-hmm.
And you do not have to be the victim in all of this. Don't
Amen to that.
Play the victim. Okay? Thanks again. Appreciate it, Scott.
Thank you, Chris.
As always,
Thank
I appreciate you. Guys, we'll see you next time. Thanks.
Have a good one.